To our internet listeners, please, we're going to continue to remind you, go down if you haven't already and subscribe to this cast so that when we come up, you'll be notified. That way you won't miss us. And also, we want to appeal to you to share with your family, your friends, your Sunday school classes that we're here so they too can join in and be blessed by the Word of God here at World Class Sunday School. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Seems like all the brother of love faded away. We welcome you to World Class Sunday School. As always, it's a pleasure to have you join us as we continue to read and study God's Word. Let us go in prayer. Lord, again, we are thankful for this time, this opportunity to share in your word. We pray that our hearts and minds are open, that we have a desire to learn more about you so we can serve you better. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. We are continuing in our 1 1/4. We're talking about justice, law, and history. And here in Unit 1, the title of Unit 1 is God Requires Justice. And today's lesson is entitled Justice and Kindness. Justice and Kindness. And our lesson is coming from the 9th chapter of 2 Samuel. And we're going to do verses 1 through verse 7 and then verse 9 through verse 12. And we're going to see here King David showing justice and kindness to Jonathan's son Mephibosheth. But to really get a better understanding of what's taking place here in chapter 9 of 2 Samuel, we're going to go back and do a little history. Now, we know that our lesson is coming from the book of Samuel, who was the writer. And Samuel was the last judge of Israel. And he was also anointed by God to be a prophet. After Moses had led the children of Israel, Joshua had led the children of Israel, then God used judges to lead Israel. At this point, Israel wanted an earthly king like all the other nations around them. God allowed it to be so after warning them how they would be treated by a king. So we see a transition here. God instructed Samuel to anoint Saul as the first king of Israel. And so, but after Saul became king, he became really proudful and disobedient to God. And God stripped him of his power. And now he instructs Samuel to go and anoint David, who was the son of Jesse, a shepherd boy, as king of Israel. But it would be some years before David would actually take the throne. But Saul had taken David into his palace, and in the beginning of their relationship, Saul was really proud of David because David was a musician, and he would soothe Saul with his music. And David was also a great warrior, and we know the story of how David slew Goliath. But Saul's son Jonathan and David, they loved one another, and they became real close friends. And Saul became jealous of David because Saul knew and Jonathan knew also that God had chosen David to be the next king of Israel. And really, Saul was so jealous of David. He tried a couple of times, several times, to take David's life, but Jonathan, his son, feel differently about it. Now, Jonathan actually was in line, as tradition would have it. He was next in line to succeed his father as king because he was the oldest son. But Jonathan knew that God had called David to be the king. And Jonathan showed his approval of that by giving David his robe. So while Saul, his father, was trying to kill David, Jonathan was standing in to protect David. But they became such close friends. They loved one another so until late they made a covenant. And we're going to look at the covenant later on as we go through our lesson. Saul, who I said was, he was still sitting on the throne and wearing the crown, but God had stripped him of his power because of his disobedience to God. And that's a note for us as Christians. We as Christians, we have power because God's Spirit lives in us. But when we are disobedient to God's word, our power becomes lessened. And so that shows us that we should always strive to be obedient to God for us to have power as Christians. So now, later on in history, Saul and Jonathan had died in a battle with the Philistines. And so now, later on, David has taken the throne of Israel, and he has become the king of all Israel. And now we're going to fast forward some 20 years, and that's when our lesson picks up here in 2 Samuel. And we're going to begin here in the first portion of our lesson is entitled Promise Remembered. Promise Remembered. And that's verses 1 through 4. So let's read verses 1 through 4. It says, "And David said, Is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? And there was of the house of Saul a servant whose name was Ziba. And when they had called him unto David, the king said unto him, Art thou Ziba? And he said, Thy servant is he. And the king said, Is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I might show the kindness of God unto him? And Ziba said unto the king, Jonathan had yet a son, which is lame in his feet. And the king said unto him, Where is he? And Ziba said unto the king, Behold, he is in the house of Micaiah, the son of Ammiel, in Lolaba. Okay, so now here our lesson focuses on the promise that David had made to Jonathan. He asked if there were any of the house of Saul remaining. Let us keep in mind this tradition that when a new king would take the throne, everyone that was associated with or in the family of the former king would be killed. And that would take away any threat of the new king being overthrown by the previous king's descendants. But here David searches for though anyone who was left of the family of Jonathan, not to destroy him, but to show kindness. He said that I might show him kindness for Jonathan's sake. Now he wasn't showing Mephibosheth. He's not going to show him kindness because of anything that Mephibosheth has done. David is making it plain and clear that he was showing kindness to Mephibosheth, who was Jonathan's son, for Jonathan's sake. And look, it's the same with us as Christians. God shows us kindness. God shows us justice and kindness, not because of what we are doing or what we've done, but he shows us justice and kindness for Christ's sake. And that's because Christ, who is God incarnated, paid our sin debt. And when we believe and know that Christ died on the cross for our sins, then God gives us justice. We don't deserve it. We didn't earn it. God gives it to us for Christ's sake, because Christ had lived a sinless life and gave his life on Calvary's cross, that we who believe in the blood of Christ would be, justice would be imputed to us. And it's not because of our good deeds or anything else, but it's because God is showing us justice because of Christ's sake. And he shows us kindness when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Then we inherit all that God has. We become his sons. And we're going to see how we benefit from that as we continue in our lesson. Now, he said David remembered the promise or the covenant that he had made with Jonathan. David's pledge to Jonathan went so far as to ensure continual kindness to the same even after the Lord had cut off the enemies of David, even from the face of the earth. So David was remembered the promise that he had made, and that's why he's calling for Mephibosheth, who is the son of Jonathan. And when Ziba told King David where Saul's son was located, Ziba said unto the king, Jonathan has yet a son, which is lame in his feet. Now notice here, he didn't call Mephibosheth's name at first, but he stated his condition. And what the covenant that David and Jonathan had made, you'll find it in 1 Samuel, the 20th chapter, verses 12 through 17. And Jonathan, the agreement was that Jonathan would protect David. Now, you said that earlier, that Jonathan's father, Saul, who was king, was out to kill David because he was jealous of David. But the agreement was that Jonathan would protect David, and David would show kindness to Jonathan's family or his house forever. That was a covenant that was made between Jonathan and David. Now, Jonathan has gone off the scene, and David is still being true to the promise he made to Jonathan. Here in the latter part of verse 3, when Ziba, who was a retainer of Saul's family, and so he knew all about where Jonathan's descendants were. And so he said that he said he has a son, but he's lame in his feet. Now, when we look back and see when Saul, King Saul, and three of his sons, including Jonathan, was killed in a battle with the Philistine, then when the caregiver or the nurse of Mephibosheth heard about the king and his sons being killed, she ran off with Mephibosheth, protecting him. And the Bible tells us in 2 Samuel 4:4 that He fell, and as a result of his falling, he was crippled in both his feet. And so this is some 20 years later. He was 5 years old when that happened. So this is some 20 years later. Now we catch up with Mephibosheth again when he's about 25 years old. And Ziba said to the king, "Behold, he is in the house of Micaiah, the son of Amiel in Lodabar." And so here, Mephibosheth was living in an obscured place called Lodabar in Gilead, which was on the other side of Jordan. Okay, so now David has found Jonathan's son, and now he's gonna. David remembered his promise, and now he's gonna fulfill his promise, and we're gonna see that in verses 5-7 and 9-12. Okay, fulfilling a promise fulfilled is what we see here, and we're gonna see the arrival of Mephibosheth. David sent for him. Then, beginning in verse 5, it says, "Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Micaiah, the son of Amiel, from Lodabar. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was come unto David, he fell on his face and did reverence. And David said, Mephibosheth, and he answered, Behold thy servant. And David said unto him, Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan thy father's sake, and will restore thee all the land of Saul thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table continually." Okay, and so here David finds Jonathan's son, and because of the promise, the covenant that David and Jonathan had, David is showing justice and kindness to Jonathan's son because of Jonathan. He says to him, fear not. Now, why would Mephibosheth be fearful of David? Now, we said earlier that the tradition was that when David succeeded Saul as king of Israel, traditionally he would have all of Saul's descendants killed to lessen any threat of an overthrow. And so Mephibosheth didn't know that David was going to show him love because of Jonathan. That's why he was fearful. But David assured him. He said, "Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness." Now, he's showing him kindness because of Jonathan's sake. And again, the Lord God shows us kindness because of Christ's sake. And he says, "I'm going to restore all the land of Saul, thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table continually." David was wrapping his arms of love around Mephibosheth and giving him everything that David owned. Mephibosheth now has access to it. And when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and God shows us justice and kindness, everything that God owns, we have access to it. Praise God, hallelujah. Thank God for that. Okay, so when you sit, you have a place at the king's table. We have a place at God's table. And this is a picture of God showing us kindness, not because of what we've done, but because of Christ's sake. And then in verse 9 and through 12, it says in verse 9, "Then the king called to Ziba, Saul's servant, and said unto him, I have given unto thy master's son all that pertaineth to Saul and to all his house. And now we're going to see the extension of the kindness that David is showing to Jonathan's son. Now, I mean, he could have just stopped at letting him eat at the table. And that would be kindness. But we're going to see how genuine love just filters down from generation to generation. But he's saying he has given him a place at the table. Now he says he's going to give him everything that pertains to Saul and to Saul's house. And okay, so let's see what that is. Thou therefore and thy sons and thy servants shall till the land for him, and thou shalt bring in the fruits, that thy master's son may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, thy master's son, will eat bread always at my table. And so everyone that was connected to Mephibosheth's family, David is giving them servants to work their land and to bring in the harvest for them. Now, Mephibosheth is eating at David's table, but he's going to be beneficiary to all that comes in to Saul's house, or to his house. And we can enjoy everything that God has because Jesus has done all the work. Now, Mephibosheth doesn't have to do any work in order to reap the benefits. We don't have to do any work because Christ has done the work for us. All we have to do is trust in him. And because of our trust in him, God will give us justice and kindness. Will show us justice and kindness. Now Zeba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then said Zeba unto the king, according to all that my lord the king has commanded his servant, so shall thy servants do. He letting David know that he and all those that served with him will be working on Mephibosheth's behalf. Okay, and then B part of 11 says, as for Mephibosheth, said the king, he shall eat at my table. Again, he's emphasizing the place that he has set aside for Mephibosheth. And when you sit at the king's table, you don't have anything to worry about. Everything the king eat, you eat. Everything that the king benefit from, then you have access to it. Everything God has, he allows us to have access to it because of Jesus Christ. And all this was produced for Mephibosheth because of the relationship between Jonathan and David. Now, all that God has, we have access to it because of our relationship with his son, Jesus Christ. Now, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then you're not going to benefit from any assets that's pertaining to God. You have to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Christ said that in order to get to the Father, we have to go through him. And to enjoy what God has for his children, you have to go through his son, Jesus Christ. And because when we establish a relationship with Christ, then we benefit because Christ is going to show us the justice and kindness because of Christ's sake. Because of our relationship with Jesus, he puts us at God's table. Okay, and then verse 12 says, and Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micaiah, and all that dwelt in his house, in the house of Zeba, were servants unto Mephibosheth. And so not only is Mephibosheth, who was Jonathan's son, Saul's grandson, benefiting from the relationship between David and Jonathan, even Mephibosheth's son is benefiting from the relationship between David and Jonathan. And so we can see how the justice and kindness is filtering down through generation after generation. And now let me just read this little paragraph here. It says, the same is true today. We are called to remember the kindness that God has shown us, especially through Jesus' life, his death, and his resurrection, and we should show that kindness to others. This may mean providing for the need of others in our communities. It could mean making restitution for wrong that we did not commit. Justice and kindness cause us to go beyond loving our friends to loving even those people who may be enemies. In this way, we demonstrate the covenant kindness of our God. God has made a covenant with us, and we reap the benefits of the covenant, the access, all the things that God possessed. We reap the benefits from those because of our relationship with his son, Jesus Christ, as was the relationship between Jonathan and David. Lord, we thank you for this time. We're always grateful, Lord, to sharing your word. And thank you, Lord, for showing us and opening up our understanding even more. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. Well, again, friends, we thank you for joining us on today, and we look forward to having you in our next session. So until then, may God richly bless and keep you, is our prayer.